for the opportunity you've given unto us to worship you. Thank you for this moment of praise. We bless your holy name for the joy that you have placed in our hearts. May your name be lifted up in the name of Jesus. As we continue with this joy, O God, we pray that nothing shall ever take our joy away from us in the name of Jesus. Every effort of the kingdom of darkness to take our joy, we pray that we never succeed in the name of Jesus. We ask, O God, that joy, O God, in abundance, we continue to be our portion in the name of Jesus. As we continue to hear your word this morning, speak to our hearts, minister to our soul, put our lives together. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
And the people of the Lord shout a louder amen.
Amen.
Please have your seat. Our text this morning is taken from the book of Genesis 24:1-12. Genesis 24:1-12. If not for the sake of time, I would have loved to read the whole chapter. But for the sake of time, I will just read the first 12 verses while I make reference to others in the course of the teaching. Now, Abraham was old, well advanced in years. And the Lord blessed Abraham in all things. And Abraham said to his servant, the oldest of his household, who had charge of all that he had, put your hand under my thigh, that I may make you swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and God of the earth, that you will not take a wife for my son from the daughters of the Canaanites, among whom I dwell, but we go to my country and to my kindred and take a wife for my son Isaac. The servant said to him, perhaps the woman may not be willing to follow me to this land. Must I then take your son back to the land from which you came? Abraham said to him, see to it that you did not take my son back there. 7. The Lord, the God of heaven, who took me from my father's house, from the land of my kindred, and who spoke to me and swore to me, to your offspring I will give this land, he will send his angel before you, and you will take a wife for my son from there. But if the woman is not willing to follow you, then you will be free from this oath of mine. Only you must not take my son back there. So the servant put his hand under his thigh, under the thigh of Abraham, his master, and swore to him concerning this matter. Then the servant took 10 of his master's camel and departed, taking all sorts of choice gifts from his master. And he arose and went to Mesopotamia, to the city of Nahor, and he made the camels kneel down outside the city by the well of water at the time of evening, the time when women go out to draw water. And he said, O Lord, God of my master Abraham, please grant me success today and show steadfast love to my master Abraham. May the Lord grant somebody success today in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Our topic this morning is orderly path to godly marriage. Orderly path to godly marriage is still in line with our theme for the month, divine order. Godly marriage is a product of divine order to replenish and to promote the beauty of the society. You can reference Genesis 2:15-18. Unfortunately, one institution in our society that is fast falling out of order is the marriage institution. Some of these disorders include divorce, broken homes, unhappy homes, crisis-ridden homes, and so on and so forth. This institution is affected by this manner of disorder. And unfortunately, when it is affected, every other person and every other institution in the society is equally affected. Why? Because the institution is the bedrock of every society. Hence, any lack of order in this institution world over is affecting all of us today. Some of the negative impacts include increase in divorce rates. I will mention that later. Various level of domestic violence we are experiencing in our society today. Husband killing wife, wife killing husband, increasing on the day. Husband breaking the nose of the wife, wife breaking the TV of the husband, and so on and so forth. Domestic violence is increasing in our society. Unfortunately, there is even other forms of violence, that violence against children, violence against children. When you listen to news, you hear all manner of violence in the family. It's a disorder. It is not the plan of God. Then we also have incest, increase in incest. One case was reported just last week of a man who impregnated his 16-year-old daughter. That's an aberration. I've had the case of siblings who impregnated themselves before. I've also had the case of a woman impregnated by the son. This is increasing in our society. It's a disorder. The Lord will deliver us in the name of Jesus. I said the Lord will deliver us in the name of Jesus. An article was published in Punch newspaper on December 5th, 2019, and the title of the article is High Rate or High Divorce Rate, Dangerous for Nigerian Society. High Divorce Rate, Dangerous for Nigerian Society. That implies that there is high divorce rate in Nigeria and it's dangerous for our society. It must be checked. One of the ways we can check it is by telling ourselves what order means in marriage. It is a disorder. The writer of that article states that study has shown that children are usually most affected in events of divorce. Children are the first people that are affected. Then these children subsequently cause havoc in the society. So when children are affected because they are product of divorce in the marriage, their life is affected. Then they will now go out and wreak havoc in the society. So society will also suffer. It's not only the immediate family that is suffering, the entire society will suffer for the disorderliness in one single marriage. That's why this issue is very serious. That's why we must take note of it. Now, the impact of this disorderliness is not limited to increase in divorce rate alone. The counselor went further to state that the negative impact of unhappy family, broken homes, and incessant crisis in the family lead children into sexual promiscuity, which is increasing in our society. I heard the story of a 14-year-old girl who met a boy on Facebook, and they connected and they met in the hotel, and she stayed with the boy in the hotel for several days. When the boy was tired, he had no money again. He handed her over to another boy who continued to stay in the hotel until police went and arrested all of them because they were kidnappers. So you see that sexual promiscuity is increasing in our society. In those days, it is something you don't see easily, but now it is becoming so rampant that boys will be carrying girls up and down, then girls too will also be carrying men up and down, and they are changing it like they are changing rappers, changing shirts. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Then we also have crime rate increasing. Teenagers involving themselves in crime, robbery, kidnapping, yahoo, all those manner of things. Teenagers. Then you find the issue of drug and substance abuse. All these things, they are the impact of disorder in the family that we have in the society. I pray this morning that the Lord Himself will deliver us in Jesus' name. Now, why are we talking about it? We are talking about it because there's a need for us to know that marriage is not something we enter into anyhow. Marriage is something that we must know the importance. Because it is not something that we can change easily. Divorce does not end the problem of marriage. Because divorce itself is no solution. And I will give you a scary statistic about marriages in America. Well, we don't have more statistics there. No, we can't say much about our country, but we know it's not as if the condition is better. But we can infer from their own statistics to address ourselves and then to also check ourselves, because if he is not taking what we are reading about them, will be read about us very soon. But that will not be our portion in Jesus' name. I said that will not be our portion in Jesus' name. But we must learn. We must learn from their example, and we must learn not to follow their lifestyle. Unfortunately today, when we are copying everything we are copying from the whites. We are copying how families should run from the whites. How a woman should behave from the white man. How a man should behave from the white man. As if the white man has become a compendium of knowledge for us when it comes to marriage. The word of God is there. Key that is telling us that this is the way. This is the brand. This is the model. If you want to live the kind of God's marriage, you want to enter the kind of God's marriage, your model is the word of God. The Bible. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I know in those days there used to be one car they call Benz 200. Mercedes-Benz 200. They call it flat boots. Very strong car. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Now that's the model of that car. That car is strong. But because they don't want to continue to produce that kind of strong car, they change the model. Because people refer to that car as German mistake. So in order not to make mistake again, they brought in new model. And anytime they bring in new model, they change what is inside the model. Unfortunately for us, there's no new model marriage. The only model marriage we have is the Bible model marriage. It is old, but it's still relevant. It has not changed. Everything about it is still the same. You cannot have a new model marriage. If you want to have new model marriage, then you will change the name. It's no longer godly marriage. Many people are entering into marriages today that is not godly. So it's no longer godly marriage, it's another marriage. If you want to enter godly marriage, follow what the Bible says. And that's what we want to follow. The Lord will help us. The Lord will help us. So God's model of marriage says divorce is not the solution. That's why God says, I hate divorce. Now listen to this statistic to prove the fact that divorce does not answer the problem of marriages. Researchers estimate that 41% of all forced marriages in U.S. will end in divorce. 41% of every marriage. He went further to say 60% of all second marriage end in divorce. So when people run away from the first marriage because there's trouble in the first marriage, they enter the second marriage, they will also leave the second marriage. Because it has increased from 41% to 60%. When it climbs to the third marriage, researchers say it goes to 73%. So the more people change marriages, the more the rate of divorce does what? Increase. So divorce is not a solution because it has never solved the problem. So we must look for another way out. One major reason why we have a lot of anomaly in our society today is how people enter into marriage in the first instance. How do they enter into marriage? To prevent our society from sliding into such dangerous trend, we must be reminding ourselves of godly path to marriage from time to time. Because if we don't know the path into godly marriage, we will also follow the same path. And when we follow the same path, we will get the same results. I pray for you this morning. You will not follow evil path in the name of Jesus. The Lord will grant you the grace to follow the good path in the name of Jesus. So, one thing I will mention this morning about the path. On Thursday, I'll continue from where I stopped. The one thing we are mentioning today is preparation. Can I hear you say with me, preparation? Say it well. Or if you like to use the Boy Scout motto, it says, be prepared. Be prepared. So if you want to enter into godly marriage, you must be prepared for it. The path to godly marriage is preparation. It's either you are prepared or you are not prepared. Preparation is key. And Jesus himself showed us the example that preparation is key. I mentioned it last week, that Jesus lived only 33 years. But out of that, those 33 years, he used 30 years to prepare for a job that he was going to do for 3 years. That's to show to us that preparation is very key. Marriage, like every other good thing in life, need much more good preparation. Why? Because you can easily change many things in life, but you cannot change marriage easily. When you know you can't change something, then you are careful how you handle that thing. When you know that something that you enter into to come out to be difficult for you, then if you are wise, you are very careful before you enter into it. And I always tell people that marriage to you should be like your second life. The reason why we care about our lives, we so much protect our lives, is because we know that once we lose it forever. We can't get it again. The same thing. Marriage should be like that too. You can't change it. You change it, it affects you for the rest of your life. I told them in the store service that if you enter into marriage this moment, just 1 minute you enter into marriage and you are pronounced husband and wife, and you decide that I don't want to go on again, and you say I want to go back, then from that moment your title will change. You will become a divorcee. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And unfortunately for you, you will carry that title for the rest of your life. Even if you marry another person, they will say it was a former divorcee before you marry somebody else. So that action has affected you for the rest of your life. So it's not something you enter into and then you come out and say, well, I made a mistake. Hey, let me change my ways now. No, be careful before you enter. Because once you enter, it affects you for life. Praise the Lord. Before you now talk of when children are involved. So it's key. No wonder Proverbs 24:27 says, put your work in order outside. Make ready in the field. After that, see to the building of your house. In other words, prepare yourself very well before you enter into marriage. Don't enter into marriage anyhow. Because if you enter into marriage anyhow, you will also run out anyhow. May the Lord help us. I say, may the Lord help us. The passage we saw, we read this morning, show us a picture of a man and his family that was fully prepared. Abraham was fully prepared to take a son for his wife, to take a wife for his son. Isaac was fully prepared to receive the wife. Rebecca herself was fully prepared to marry the person that God has chosen for her. They were all fully prepared. That narrative shows to us that they were fully prepared. They did not just wake up overnight and say, well, I want to do this thing now. Like many people will do today, just decide to impregnate any girl and then you begin to live together. Then you say, you are not husband and wife. In fact, some people will even cohabit for years, sleeping together, giving birth to children, yet they are not married. And they want good results. They can't get good results. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. May the Lord open our eyes to follow God's example. I say, may the Lord open our eyes to follow God's example in the name of Jesus. Now, what are those things involved in your preparation? Number one, in your preparation is the salvation of your soul. Salvation of your soul, very key. The first foundation you must put in order before you ever dream of marriage is the salvation of your soul. Young people in the house, I'm addressing you mostly this morning. The salvation of your soul is key. Very key. When your children encourage you to come to church, they are encouraging you to come to church because of good things they want to happen in your life. Don't take it for granted. Don't come to church for coming sake. Come to church and surrender your life to Christ. Let the church have its way in your life by transforming you to become like Christ. Don't just come for coming sake. Don't say, well, I just want to follow them. Make I just follow them. Because at times, when people follow, not from their own will, you see them in church. Some of them will just sit aloof. You are praying, they are just looking. You are singing, they are just looking. Sing what you will sing. And let us sing. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. That would be a sign of somebody who has not had an encounter with God. Someone who has encountered God. You cannot enter the presence of God and remain the same and go by the same way you came. When you enter with the mind that I want to know God. Open my eyes. Whatever they do, you do. This morning as I was waiting, I was listening to a message on radio. TDCS was preaching and he was saying that some of us, when we come before the presence of God, we come fully intact. We are not willing to open up ourselves. He said, break that alabaster box. Until you break that alabaster box, before the fragrance of your life come out. So we must be willing to release ourselves unto God. We must be willing to let God to have his way in our life. Every area of our life. Not only when it comes to marriage, but that we are laying a foundation for our life that this is I want God to take over and take charge of my life so that I can stand for him and live for him. That's the foundation. When that is in order, that's your first preparation. May the Lord help us.
Amen.
I say may the Lord help us.
Amen.
I say may the Lord help us.
Amen.
Because a child who is truly born again will not carry another girl and go and stay in the hotel. A child who is truly born again will not go and be sleeping with a girl that is not married to. A child who is fully born again will not leave her parents' home and go and sleep with another boy. That's why it's key. Foundation is key. That foundation is key. Salvation. Very key. We can spend the whole day talking about salvation. We can't joke with it. Civilization has not changed it. No wonder the Bible says, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. May the Lord help us. Number two, prayer. Prayer is key in preparing for a godly marriage. Very key. We saw in the passage we read that Eliezer prepared properly in prayer for the kind of woman he wanted for his master's son. Look at verses 12 to 14. And he said, O Lord God of my master Abraham, please grant me success today. And what was the success? He says, behold, I am standing by the spring of water, and the daughter of men of the city are coming out to draw water. Let the young woman to whom I shall say, please let down your jar that I may drink. And who shall say, drink, and I will water your camels. Let her be the one whom you have appointed for my master's son, Isaac. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. In that prayer, I see a man who was using prayers to prepare his ways. He was using prayer to direct the path of his life. He was using prayer to make the choice that God will want for his life. And in making those choices, he made mention of some important things. Number one, he talks about the issue of a young virgin lady. Praise the Lord. Not a girl that have scattered her life with different kind of boys. Not a boy who has scattered his life with different kind of girls. Today, when you ask our young people, how many of them are still virgin? The result you will get. Fear will catch you. Praise the Lord. As if virginity has become a taboo. Young boys sleeping with everything in skirts. Young girls sleeping with anything in trousers. How will they not enter into trouble in marriage? Bible says, when the foundation be destroyed, what can the righteous do? When the foundation is scattered, then the end result will also be scattered. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So he wanted a virgin, and it was not negotiable. Then he went further. He was looking for an industrious woman. When you look at his condition that he gave in that passage that I just finished reading from 12 to 14, the condition he gave, he says, the woman, and when I ask her, please give me water, she will not only give me water, she will also give my camel water. Camel, don't joke with water. When camel drink water, they can finish your well. Because they are desert animals. They have very large storage in their system where they can store water that will take them several miles. So when they have opportunity to drink, they drink and drink. And this woman said, sit down, sir. I will give you water. After I've given you water, wait for me. I'm going to give your camel water. 10 camels. One woman was giving them water. Hard work. Today, when some people are looking for people to marry, oh God, I want a very handsome boy. Very handsome, young looking boy. Tall. Light in complexion. Or some that like that. Say dark in complexion. Then the other one says, I want a very sweet 16. Very young, beautiful lady. You don't even know what you are looking for. That's why even after getting that young, handsome man, when trouble comes in that marriage, you are willing to say, I beg, I don't want to do it again. You forget the beauty. When you marry that beautiful young lady, when trouble comes, you are not afraid to be busting that beautiful face. And that was what attracted you to her in the first instance. But you forget that she's beautiful, and you start punching her. The other time I saw one on Facebook, honestly, as I was seeing it, my body was shaking. The guy was just, as if he was doing practice, and it was real life. I said, oh my God, how can somebody be so callous? A man, very hefty, very huge. And until the woman ran away. May you not fall into the wrong guy. I said, may you not fall into the wrong guy. Please, don't take this matter lightly. This matter is very important. You can see me sweating. I'm not just sweating. I'm sweating because of the seriousness of this matter. This matter is one of my greatest passions in ministry. I don't joke with it. Because it has destroyed many lives. Very beautiful life. With great future. I've seen them crumble because of error in marriage. I've heard of people die prematurely because of marriage. I've seen people's future truncated because of destiny marriage. Eliezer was prepared. He knew what he wanted. Thank God for that kind of man. He was not looking for anything. Yes, he was looking for the right thing because he was fully prepared in prayer. You must also pray. Prayer is key. The Lord will help us. Amen. I said the Lord will help us. Amen. Eliezer knew the importance of prayer. Abraham knew the importance of prayer. Even Isaac knew the importance of prayer. Go and read that scripture. You will see that before Rebekah came, Bible says Isaac went to the field and he was meditating. He was praying and meditating and asking God and praying to God. That was his lifestyle. No wonder they didn't make mistake, because they prepared well in prayer. May the Lord help you to prepare. I say, may the Lord help you to prepare. Your preparation will afford you the opportunity to pray in line with what God is doing in your life. There is what God is doing in your life. When you prepare, it will help your prayer life. It will direct what you will pray about. If you look at that scripture we read, Bible says, before Rebekah came, Eliezer, servant of Abraham, was praying. And everything he was praying about was in line with what God was doing. Why? Because Bible says, before he finished praying, Rebekah came. Which means Rebekah must have left her house before the man started praying. Because he was a man of prayer who was praying before and who continued to pray, God was also working in his heart. All those prayer points the man was praying, it was God that dropped it in his heart. That's why when Rebekah came, it matches everything the man was requesting for, because the Spirit of God was working in the life of all of them. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So when you pray, it prepares your life. The desire of God will be put in your heart. Somebody says, prayer does not change God. It is we that prayer change. So when you pray so much, the prayer will affect your life. You begin to love what God loves, not what you love. Then you'll be able to move in tandem with the will of God for your life, and you make the right choice. May the Lord grant you grace to pray. May the Lord grant you grace to pray. Another thing we must do in preparing is that you must enroll yourself for marital knowledge. Enroll yourself for marital knowledge. Just like somebody who will go to school, enroll himself in school. Enroll yourself for marital knowledge. Seek marital knowledge. Read widely about marriage. Read Christian books. Relevant Christian books. When I say read, I'm talking about Christian books, not anyhow books. Some people are writing books today, but they are not in order. Christian books, books that when you put it side by side with scripture, you see that, yes, this is in line with scripture. Read. When people come for counseling, they are preparing for marriage. I ask them, how many books have you read about marriage? Some will say, well, I've not read. Some will say, I just said, one. But even the one myself, I didn't finish reading. But you want to marry. But unfortunately, they think that when it comes to marriage, the only thing that is important in marriage is sex. So once I know how to go to bed with the, what do I need again? I have everything. And unfortunately, on the day of marriage, as they are finishing, we are pronouncing the husband and wife, we carry certificates and give to them. Then the certificate will let them see themselves as, yes, you have arrived. I'm now a married man. Married man that does not know anything. Praise the Lord. You can imagine somebody just coming out and say, I'm now a doctor. A medical doctor. And he did not go to medicine school. He didn't go to medical school. He didn't read any book about medicine. And he says, I'm now a medical doctor. You will laugh at him. Would you laugh? You will laugh. Praise the Lord. Unfortunately, that's how many people behave when it comes to marriage. They just enter, bam. Oh yeah, I'm now a married man. Respect me now. Married man. It's not just about certificate. That certificate we gave to you, you can't present it anywhere. What will help you is not that certificate. What will help you is what you know. And how you know is by your study. Read widely. Read Christian books. Read and read and read. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I believe that Eliezer knew very much about marriage. Abraham, the father of Isaac, knew much about marriage. And I also believe that Isaac must have been tutored by his mother. So they were not novices. They knew what they wanted. Unfortunately today, we discover that people are not ready. The Lord will help us. Another area of preparation is premarital counseling. Premarital counseling is part of your preparation. You must enter into godly marriage. You mustn't joke with premarital counseling. But I've been a pastor for some time, and I know the attitude of many people towards premarital counseling is not too encouraging. In fact, there are times we are tempted to tell, is it because you people are not paying money? If you pay money, you will take it more serious. Abi? Praise the Lord. Because at times when something is free, people don't know the value. If for every hour you come for counseling, you pay a particular amount of money for the counseling, some people will take it more serious than the way they are taking it now. A group of researchers did a research in the year 2000, that's 2000, the year 2000. And they reported that despite more extensive training of providers than two decades ago, in other words, 20 years ago, in 2000, which is 1980, people are not as educated in the training of marriage as it was in 2000, when it talks about service provider. Service provider are those counselors, those pastors that are preparing people, those are the service provider. While service provider are improving in their knowledge, reading, getting more knowledge, studying the word of God to come out with what God wants us to do, the people that are supposed to enroll for the training are reducing. According to that researcher, he said one third of people preparing for marriage takes the issue serious. One over three. The rest, they don't take it serious. And I can affirm to that's the truth. As of 2000. If the research is done in 2020, I don't know what the result will be. Maybe it will not be 1/5. People are improving every day, studying about marriage. Go to the market store, any Christian bookstore. Go and ask, find out books about marriage. You see a lot. Go and read about, go and find out articles about marriage. Carry your book, just Google marriage. You will see books. Unfortunately, people are not studying. Counseling, they are not taking it serious. May the Lord help us. I say, may the Lord help us. There is also post-wedding counseling. After wedding. When they are not taking the premarital counseling serious, is it the post they will take serious? And I told them in the previous services that when we talk about counseling, counseling is not that because you have trouble. Counseling is that you want to refresh yourself. Just like you take your vehicle to the mechanic workshop, you want to service it, change the engine oil, put a new engine oil, a new filter. Then by the time you do that, the vehicle comes better. The sound change. You can enjoy it in good ride because you have just done service. Many marriages have not been serviced. 20 years down the line, no servicing. You drive one car for 20 years, the engine no go knock. Huh? One car for 20 years, no servicing. The engine will knock, no matter how good that car is, it will knock. You just face LMA Road. Before you reach Akpabio, you are the Lord will deliver us. I say the Lord will deliver us. Yeah. Another thing in preparation is abstinence from premarital sex. Abstinence. 1 Thessalonians 4:3-4 says, "For this is the will of God, your sanctification, that you abstain from sexual immorality." Is he talking only to boys or to girls alone? I'm not hearing you. He's talking to both boys and who? Both boys and girls. He said, abstain from sexual immorality. That each one of you should know how to control his own body in holiness and honor. sexual immorality will destroy your path to a godly marriage. Some people ended up marrying their girlfriend and they left their wives. Because why? They saw one girl and they started sleeping with the girl, and before they knew what was happening, they impregnated the girl and they didn't have option that to marry the girl. Unfortunately, that was not their wife. So sexual immorality is not good for anybody, whether for a boy or for a girl. You must run away from it. If you are preparing for a godly home, prepare now. Know that if you don't know before, now you are hearing it. That it is not a path for you to follow. I cannot be sleeping with every girl I see and I say I want to marry tomorrow. After I finish destroying the life of some girls, I will now go to church and pray to God and say, God, give me a good wife. God will just be laughing at you. All those who are showing you don't destroy, we will marry them. If you want to prepare for a good future, run away from sexual immorality. That 5 minutes act can destroy your entire future. No wonder Joseph, he was very wise. Joseph was a very wise man. When Potiphar's wife came, say, ah, oh boy, come, I'm going to you know me. Hey, the guy said, no spoil my future. I have a glorious future waiting for me. God has shown to me that I'm going to be the prime minister of this land one day. You won't spoil it with this one. 5 minutes? No. Instead of me to go to bed with you for 5 minutes, I better go back to prison and spend 11 years or how many years in prison. It doesn't matter to me. I will not destroy this one. I will go to prison. And he went to prison. And eventually, when the time was right, he came to the throne. Hallelujah. But you know how funny it is? When the man landed on the throne, the kind of wife they gave to him, my God. When the devil is tempting you, it's because he knows that there's one glorious thing waiting for you. If you are a boy here and all guests are running after you, all the time they are running after you, know that they are seeing something that you are not seeing. There is one glory over your life that they want to take, they want to destroy. If you are wise, you will run for your life. If you are a girl, everybody sees, oh girl, you fire, see your leg. Know that they are seeing something they want to destroy. Run for your life. If you don't run, you will just destroy your future. May your future never be destroyed in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
I say, may your future never be destroyed in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
Rebecca prepared her future well. Isaac also prepared his future well. They ran away from all these kind of things. And eventually when they entered pure. Isaac was a virgin. Rebecca was a virgin. They entered pure. And they give birth to God this seed. Praise the Lord. Now listen to this, so that you won't say, they are just quoting Bible. All the time, Bible, Bible. Because some people think that Bible. Okay, let me quote one research. So that you know that what we are saying is not just Bible. Some people have confirmed it physically between you and me. A researcher showed that women who experience premarital sex, by premarital sex, it includes intercourse or oral sex, with at least a non-committed partner, had lower marital satisfaction than those who did not. Is that Bible? Huh? Bible was written several years ago. This researcher did his research in 2005. 15 years ago. And he came out with this report. That they gathered people together and they conducted research, asking questions. And they find out that those who had premarital sex before they enter into marriage, they are not experiencing satisfaction in their married life. Whereas those who did not experience premarital sex are experiencing satisfaction. The research was conducted on women. Well, that's one funny thing with research. You can't do everything. You only pick one area. So this man only picked woman. I know that if you do the same research, I will be amazed. The same thing will be the result. When you hear some men say, why do they chop only pomo all the time? The reason why they are saying that is because they've scattered their life with many women. So what they are doing in their brain is they are comparing, compare this, compare that, compare this. That's why they can never be satisfied. You want to enter godly marriage? The key, one of the key to entry is preparation. We cannot oversight the subject of preparation. It is key, it is very important. You can't joke with it. So if you want your future home to be good, young people in the house, if you want your future to be good, prepare it now. Start from now. Start preparing for that future home that is good. Maybe you're also an adult here. In the course of all my speaking, you know that when you enter anyhow. And you are now looking back and say, hey God, if I know that time, maybe I will not enter the way I enter. Well, our God is a God of second chance. You can always help you. You can always repair your damaged past so that your future can be better. If you find yourself in that category this morning, all you'll be needing to do is to be calling upon God, that God, forgive me of all those abnormalities in my life. I did not know them, but now I know. If you pray that simple prayer before God, I am sure that God will answer your prayer. But for young people in the house, good luck for you, because you have not made a mistake. And I pray you never make a mistake in the name of Jesus. Except maybe those who have been sleeping with boys who have been sleeping with girls, well, it's not too late. You can also cry on God for mercy and say, God, I didn't know that my life that I'm living like this before will destroy it. You can cry unto God for mercy. And our God is a merciful God. Let's be upstanding this morning as we pray to God. Let's be upstanding as we pray to God. If you fall into these categories that I've just mentioned, why don't you just lift up your voice and talk to God? Lift up your voice and don't camouflage. Some of us like camouflaging so much. You better cry to God. He knows you more than you can know yourself. He knows you. That packaging that you are packaging, you can only package before yourself, not before God. Why don't you unpackage yourself before God? Unpackage yourself. Tell him who you are. Tell him the mistake you have made before you enter into marriage. Tell him how you have entered into that present marriage in the midst of disorder. Ask him for mercy. Ask him for mercy. Asking for mercy. I'm not telling you that you should pack out of that marriage, but I'm telling you that you can commit your life, ask God for forgiveness, and let him take charge of the remaining part of your life. That's what God can do. You're a young person in the house, you know you are living in a promiscuous way, you are living in sexual immorality. God wants to have mercy upon you this morning. Why don't you call upon him and say, God, have mercy upon me. Have mercy upon me. Ask him for mercy, he will show you mercy. The God we serve is a merciful God. While every eye remains closed. Maybe you are living in sexual immorality. You've had a message this morning and you want to ask God, God, deliver me from this spirit of sexual immorality. Raise up your hands as we pray together. Without the losing of time, my time is even fast spent. But you are living in immorality, raise up your hands. God wants to deliver you. He wants to deliver you. He wants to deliver you. As you raise up that hand, as you raise up your hand, he will deliver you. It's a merciful God. It's a merciful God. All right. Maybe you are watching me online and you are affected by that. You can also key unto God. In whatever area this has affected you, you can also cry unto God. Cry unto him. He's not sending this word to you in vain. He's sending this word to you because he wants to do a new thing in your life. Cry unto him as he shows you mercy. Because he's a God of mercy. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Father, we pray this day that all that are connecting to you, O God, one way or the other, you know their hearts, we ask, meet them at the point of their needs in the name of Jesus. Amen. Bible told us that before Eleazar finished praying, you granted him the request he was asking of you. I pray this morning that you will also answer your people according to the request of their heart in the name of Jesus. Every heart, O God, that is repenting before you this morning, I pray, O God, show mercy from above in the name of Jesus. If there's any young person in the house, oh God, Father, who is still living in the morality or watching me, oh God, even, oh God, Father, through Facebook or whatever means, I pray, oh God, Father, this day, oh God, you will cause them to totally surrender themselves unto you in the name of Jesus. And as we trust you, oh God, Father, you will order our path in the path of godly marriages in the name of Jesus. Our lives will never remain the same. Thank you, Father. We give you all the glory. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.